Well, thank you very much for coming out this afternoon. Before the music starts a little bit later to hear a little bit about Stevie, it's a shame that Stevie can't be here to perform at this wonderful facility, but here we are. I feel right at home. I see that Tom and I both decided to wear bolo ties today. And if you have a keen eye during this presentation, you will see this on the screen being worn by someone else. I guess, you know, Tom is giving you a little bit of introduction to Stevie. He probably doesn't need, his music probably doesn't need a lot of introduction this close to where he was born and raised in Oak Cliff. He is regularly ranked among the greatest electric guitar players of all time in the company of Jimi Hendrix, Eric Clapton, and Jimmy Page. Different polls put him in different places, but typically he's in the top tier with those folks. Although he first stepped into a recording studio in 1970, his primary output was with his band Double Trouble from 1983 until his death in 1990 in a helicopter accident after a performance with Eric Clapton, Robert Cray, and Buddy Guy, among others. As Tom mentioned, I'm here largely because of this book. It is about 5 pounds. It makes a nice doorstop, if nothing else. But in approaching this book, I had a couple of things in particular that I wanted to do. I wanted to talk to the people who knew Stevie the best, as Tom alluded to, and also I wanted to heavily illustrate it, as no other book on Stevie has ever been illustrated. So in writing and doing the research, I wanted to talk with family members, girlfriends, band members, business associates, the people who were actually closest to Stevie throughout his life, close friends. But most importantly, I wanted to find the band members who had played with Stevie in the early years, from when Stevie was 12 years old until he was about 20. And so that would take us up to the mid-70s. Once we get to the mid-70s, that's where most of the relatively common knowledge about Stevie begins. At that point, he's already in Austin, Texas. He's playing with a band called Paul Ray and the Cobras, one of the most popular dance bands and blues bands in Austin in the 70s. So my interest was not so much in retelling the story that's been told and retold and retold in guitar magazine articles and things like that, but to go back to the people and try to figure out how did Stevie get to that point where that story begins with this awesome guitar player that everybody thinks was a sensation overnight. Well, obviously it wasn't overnight. And in laying out the book, I selected about 1,000 images from many thousands of photographs. There are pictures of Stevie on stage and off, concert posters, documents, and other memorabilia illustrated in the book. Some things like guitars that Stevie designed himself, things like that that you'll not find anywhere else. Thankfully, Stevie's mother, Martha, had been a good friend of mine for many years, and she opened up the family photo albums for my access for this book. And that's the source of most of the childhood photos of Stevie. And really, without her generosity, the book would not be the same at all, because the first half would have almost no illustrations, because nobody else had ever seen those photos. They'd not been published anywhere else. And without Martha, like I say, it would have been much, much lesser of a book. And also, Stevie's fiance, Stevie's girlfriend for the last 4 years of his life, Jonna, opened up Stevie's own photo collection for me to pick some candid photographs from. And so that also really helped illustrate the book, and at least in my eyes, and I hear that the people who have they spend hours just looking at the photos before they ever even start thinking about reading it. And that's fine. That's good. If nothing else, there's a lot of great pictures. But there is a lot more to the book. And I'm going to share a little bit of that, some stories from the book with you this afternoon. The book includes, and what you will see here in a minute, the first and last pictures of Stevie that were taken. There are some very historic photos that I'll get to in just a minute. I'll show you some of my favorites, and I'm going to also play for you snippets of some very rare recordings that you're not likely to hear anywhere else and possibly ever again unless you come to some other presentation of mine. They are extremely interesting from a historical perspective. This is, to the best of my ability to determine from Martha Vaughn's family scrapbooks, this is the first picture ever taken of Stevie. And there were some other similar ones that were a little bit later. But this one, I looked at it and I thought, oh, he's playing air guitar. So again, fortunately, because of Martha Vaughn, we've got some great, great shots. These first few pictures, just some of the favorites that I saw in Martha's scrapbook, and there's a few that came from her brother, Stevie's uncle, Joe Cook. And Stevie, of course, grew up in Oak Cliff. This particular photograph here, I believe, is one of the most historic photos in the book. This snapshot was in the possession of Stevie's fiancée. On the back of this photograph, Stevie handwrote, first band, first performance. So this is it. This is in Oak Cliff. This is the very beginning of Stevie's career. That's it. That's the genesis of his public career. And I couldn't believe that that photo even exists for our historical enjoyment. But you know, we see Stevie here at a fairly young age in this top left photo. The taller guy with the dark jacket, that's Jimmy Vaughn, that's Stevie's brother. And then Stevie is in the blue and white shirt next to him. Stevie is sitting in with Jimmy's first band called the Swinging Pendulums, or just the Pendulums as they became. And then in the lower, in the lower picture, I'm not sure who that guy is standing behind Stevie. Stevie's in the foreground. Looks kind of like Buddy Holly, but of course it's not Buddy Holly. It's just the glasses that make him look like that. If anybody out there knows who that guy is, I would love to know. But you know, here, you know, Stevie at a young age, he's been playing guitar for 4 or 5 years. And, you know, he came to his dad one day and said, "Dad, I want to grow up and be a guitar player." And Big Jim Vaughn looked at his son and said, "You can't do both." We could go to the next one. This is another band Stevie was in his teen years. Again, all of this is local to the Dallas area, all of this stuff. And Stevie's already looking cool in his shades. That's Stevie in the center. We can go to the next one. This is a band called Southern Distributor. And the guitar, these guys are standing on the roof of the guy in the band jacket's house. And the guitar that's sitting on the roof with it, you know, with the back to you, is currently on display at the Grammy Museum in Los Angeles, along with a couple of items from my collection. But that's one of the few guitars that we know of that that belong to Stevie that is in private hands. And it's exceptionally valuable. I think they have it insured for $1 million. But anyway, that's an interest on that one. This is the most recent piece of memorabilia that I have acquired. I just got this a few weeks ago. This is the back of a photograph of that same band that we just saw a picture of. And what it is, Stevie's about 15 years old at this point, and he had met some girl and became pen pals and telephone pals with this girl who lived out of town. And so he sent her this picture. And the part that got me was kind of there in the middle. where he says, this is to a chick I may never see but can really dig over the phone. And I just thought, boy, that just screams the 60s and a 15-year-old. And so it's one of the earliest pieces of memorabilia that, you know, Stevie signed that I've come across. So that was from 1969. This is a picture of Stevie just at a jam session at Sunset High School in Dallas. He's playing that same guitar that I pointed out earlier. It's a 1951 Broadcaster for all you guitar heads out there. But anyway, at this point, I would ask if I'm going to play you a couple of clips of Stevie playing at about this time, not with these guys that he's with in this picture, but it's about the same time period. And these are from the earliest known recording of Stevie that anyone has discovered. These recordings are from 1969. They were recorded at a club in Dallas called the End of Coal Avenue. He's sitting in with Mark Benno's band. And the reason he was able to sit in that night, apparently he walked in wearing a white t-shirt and carrying this guitar over his shoulder and said, hey, can I sit in with y'all? And of course he was much younger than the guys up there on the stage. And Mark told me that he looked at Stevie and said, well, who are you? And Stevie says, well, I'm Jimmy Vaughn's brother. And he says, oh, come on up, take my guitar. Because at that point in time, Jimmy was known as one of the best guitar players in Dallas. And so in the early years, when Stevie's 14, 15 years old, some doors opened for him by just saying, I'm Jimmy Vaughn's brother. These are just a few seconds long, just to give you a taste. I was interviewing the guys that played with Stevie in this time period, the mid-60s to the early 70s, a couple of things stood out. One, Stevie was typically in bands with guys who were a little bit older. And when you're a teenager, 13, 14, 15 years old, and you're playing with someone who's even 1 or 2 years older, as you know, that's a huge difference in age for teenagers. And I thought it showed a lot of respect that these guys who were, you know, 2, 3 years older, 16, 17, 18 years old, would even think to allow a kid who was, you know, 13 or 14 to play with them in a band. So there was a lot of early respect for Stevie's ability. The other thing they kept saying, and it's related to that fact, they said, well, he was so good at 15, and I kept thinking as I interviewed these guys, well, they mean he was good for a 15-year-old. But you be the judge. I mean, those recordings you just heard, it's certainly not the Stevie Ray Vaughan we came to know from his recordings in the 80s, but there's a lot of skill there. I mean, I've been playing since I was 14 years old. Yeah, I can't do that. This is a band called Liberation, and this is about 1970. Fortunately, this lady, Connie Forster, her brother was in the band, and she was the only person I've been able to find who had pictures of the band. And that's the case with a lot of these early pictures of these bands that you've just seen. Photographs of these early bands from the 60s are really hard to find. And she had about three different snapshots taken the same night, and that's all I've been able to find. And of course, that was one of my standard questions anytime I interviewed somebody: do you have any recordings and do you have any photographs? And they're really hard to find. And in a lot of cases, the pictures that are in the book are the only known pictures of those particular bands. And this is no exception. This band, I'm going to play you a couple of audio clips also. I managed to find a guy who had recorded on an inexpensive portable reel-to-reel tape recorder, had recorded this band at some gig. And one of the band members told me that there was this kid in high school who had followed the band, and he thought he might have some recordings. And miraculously, not only did I find the guy, but he still had the tapes. And so let me play you a little bit of this band. This band is Stevie's largest band of his career. It's a 9 or 10 piece horn band. And they played a lot of the radio top 40 hits from bands like Chicago and Blood, Sweat, and Tears, you know, the bands that had horns. Guitar players will recognize that song. The rest of you may recognize this thing. That's Stevie in a horn band. Not likely to hear that anywhere else. The man that I found that had made these tapes had about 4 hours of tapes from two or three different gigs. And there's only been a few people that have heard it. I've played those clips. I played them in Memphis at a Blues Foundation luncheon one time. And I may have played them at the Dallas Guitar Show a couple of years ago. That's about it. Y'all are really part of a small group that have heard some of these early tapes. I wanted to read you a little bit from the book about this band. Mike Day was the drummer for the band, and unfortunately he has since passed away since I did this interview. But he was talking about the band and said, the guy who was running the little club circuit in Dallas had connections with the group that ran Caesar's Palace, the hotel in Lake Tahoe, and the Newport in Miami, and they had a circuit of their own that they wanted us to play. It was very interesting. These were guys you would consider were more like the organized type. Very nice people, but you wouldn't want to cross them. They loved us and were ready to book us, which would have been pretty good, but Stevie was 15, so they said, you'll have to replace the young lead guitar player. We said, we don't think so. They also wanted us to back up the Coasters, which is not what we were interested in doing musically. I think we all had a little different aspirations, and Stevie was committed to playing the blues. Stevie and I and some other members of the band would go off and play other clubs under made-up names, and we'd just jam, just play the blues. In Liberation, we did a pretty wide variety of music, Chicago, Blood, Sweat, and Tears. Then we did Cream or something else with Clapton, or a lot of Hendrix. And we played blues, watching the black people come up and talk to Stevie and say, you're black. I think that meant more to Stevie than any of the accolades that anybody else showered on him. And then there's a quote from Stevie himself in a later interview that said, Stevie says, "There's nights when I feel like I play better, and there's nights that, for lack of a better way to say it, I feel like the whitest guy that walks." So anyway, let's go to the next slide there. The top left picture is a band that Stevie was in called Texas Storm with his brother Jimmy. And in this particular band, Stevie played bass. And the guy over his shoulder in the blue shirt, that's Doyle Bramhall. And anybody that knows or begins to learn about the history of Stevie will hear the name Doyle Bramhall a lot. And of course, it's Doyle's son, Doyle Bramhall II, that currently plays in Eric Clapton's band, Sheryl Crow, Roger Waters, making a real name for himself as a guitar player. And that's this guy's son. And then the other picture is a band called Lincoln, a fairly short-lived band. There's a couple of people in that picture that all I know about them is that they were students at North Texas State University at the time. The blonde guy standing in the middle in the back, and I think the guy to his right. Have never been able to figure out what their names are. I've talked to three of the people in that picture. They can't remember. So again, there's a little piece of information that's still out there somewhere that I haven't been able to find. Let's go to the next slide there. Another couple of short, one short-lived band, Pecos, very short-lived. This was a band that started out in Lancaster. And Stevie had to drop out of this band fairly quickly because he didn't have any reliable way to get to Lancaster where they practiced. That is the only known picture of that band with Stevie in it. That's him in the background behind the drummer. And then the other picture is a portrait of what most people consider Stevie's truly first professional band. It's called Blackbird. He started it in the Dallas area, and that's the band that he moved to Austin in the early 70s when he started his career down in Austin. The black singer in the top center of that picture is the same singer that had been in Lincoln. Let's go to the next slide. This is a rare performance shot of Blackbird. There's a couple of portraits of Blackbird that circulate and have been published in magazines and things. This I found in a Lancaster High School annual. They were just playing a gig for the high school, probably some kind of dance. And so there you are, one of the very few pictures. You'll notice that there's two drum kits. Blackbird emulated the Allman Brothers Band by having two guitar players, two drummers. And by all accounts, it was a smoking band and became very popular in Austin as soon as they hit the scene down there. Next slide, please. Some people, we're starting to get to a point in Stevie's career where people have started to hear a little bit about these bands. This is Cracker Jack. And you'll notice, you may recognize some of the names. Uncle John Turner and Tommy Shannon in particular had been in Johnny Winter's band and had played Woodstock. That was their claim to fame at that point. And then the other guitar player in the band was Robin Seiler. You see standing next to, Stevie's at the far end there on the far right, and then Robin Seiler next to him. Tommy Shannon would later be a member of Double Trouble with Stevie and play with Stevie the rest of his career. And this wasn't even the first band that Tommy had been in with Stevie. He kind of came and went throughout Stevie's career, and a lot of people don't know that he had played with Stevie before he was a member of Double Trouble. Next slide. And this is the band called the Nightcrawlers. And we hear the name Doyle Bramhall again. That's Doyle on the front fender of the truck. Stevie sitting on the running board of the truck. This band gave Stevie his first real taste of studio recording. Now, he had been in the studio once or twice to record a couple of songs here and there. But this band actually went to Los Angeles, recorded at Sunset Sound for A&M Records, but unfortunately the album that they recorded out there was never released. If you're lucky, you can find a collector's CD out there because Mark Benno has released that album on a limited edition disc. So if you're lucky, you might be able to find that Nightcrawlers material. Next slide, please. And this is the band Paul Ray and the Cobras. And again, this is pretty much where a lot of people's knowledge of Stevie begins. Because at this point, he's in a band that's really well known in Austin. They get a lot of publicity. They won a Band of the Year contest in 1976. And so from this point, things may start to look a little familiar. Let me back up just a second, not the picture-wise, but let me back up here a little bit. I wanted to read you another story about that band called Blackbird, and I skipped over it. I'm interviewing a guy named Mike Harrison who played in a band called Orchrist with Stevie, and he is describing a club that maybe some of y'all are familiar with called The Cellar. And there was a Cellar club in Dallas and one in Fort Worth and one in Houston, and I think for a short time in San Antonio, but that was later. Mike Harrison recalls this club that Stevie played until sometimes 5 or 6 in the morning when he was just 15, 16, 17 years old. Mike says, the waitresses all walked around in bras and panties. Every once in a while, there'd be one who was shy and wear a bikini. The stage was floor level. Then there was a riser in front of it about 2 feet high and 2 feet wide, and it ran the whole length in front of the bandstand. The girls would get up there and dance on this in front of the band. In Fort Worth, for the Fort Worth Club, there was a long stairway down from the street. In Houston and Dallas, there was a long hallway from the front door to the seating area in the club. Pat Kirkwood, the owner, had an injunction against the police in each city. They couldn't come in without showing ID at the door. After they would pass the door, the guy would flip a light switch that would turn on a blue light bulb on the ceiling of the cellar, letting everyone know the police were coming in. So, anything that was going down, like if the girls had their tops off, which happened a lot, or someone had alcohol they weren't supposed to have, they would see that blue light and straighten up. One night at the Houston Cellar, we had undercover Houston narcotics agents who were dressed as preppies, college students, and we had liquor control board guys undercover, all dressed in Western wear as cowboys, and neither knew the other was in the club. So we had a waitress going to the narcotics officer saying, those cowboys over there said, y'all aren't anything but a bunch of punks. And then they'd say something, and she'd go over to the LCB guys and say, those college guys over there said, y'all aren't nothing but a bunch of redneck a-holes. So before the night was over, we had the LCB and the narcotics division in a fist fight. And we just stood there and laughed at them. So that was the Cellar. That's the kind of environment Stevie was in as a teenager starting to play music. Let's go to the next slide. Let's see where we are. Triple Threat. Triple Threat, the band is called Triple Threat Review. And you probably know that a review means there's a lot of different performers. Paul Ray and the Cobras was actually a review in the sense that all the members of the band took the spotlight at some point during the show and either did a song that they wrote or a song that they liked to sing. And this band that Stevie started after Paul Ray and the Cobras was no different. And it was called Triple Threat Review. And most people think, well, Triple Threat means Stevie, W.C. Clark, you see in the center, and Lou Ann Barton, who was a singer. And those were the three that they referred to as Triple Threat. Well, that's not true. Because this was a true review, all five members of the band would take the spotlight at various points in the show. And so it was, if anything, it was a quintuple threat review. But the name Triple Threat, I believe, got its genesis because Stevie had a nickname for a short time in his early years, and he himself was called Triple Threat because he could play guitar, bass, and drums. So, just a little tidbit there for you. If we go to the next slide, let's see where we are. Okay, 1981. By 1981, the band is pretty well set in terms of personnel. It's Stevie, Tommy Shannon playing bass, Chris Layton playing drums. And the band would not change its lineup but one more time in 1985 with the addition of Reese Winans on keyboards. This picture actually was taken at Lee Park in Dallas. So if it looks somehow familiar, it may be that you've been in that location. And at this point, Stevie's, what is he? He's about 20, what is he? He's 27, thanks. And I wanted to read a little piece from, I think this is going to be the last piece I'm going to read out of the book, a little piece from Denny Freeman. Some of you may know who Denny Freeman is. He was the other guitar player in Paul Ray and the Cobras. And in recent years, he's been a member of Bob Dylan's band and is really well-respected in the industry. And Denny is talking about Stevie as a 20-something. And it'll give you a little bit of idea, you know, that Stevie was just a regular guy. And Denny told me, he says, Stevie was younger than the rest of us, and he could be frustrating to deal with. Like, say we were getting ready to drive to Lubbock for a gig, and we're supposed to meet at the drummer's house by noon. By 12:30, everybody's there except Stevie. Somebody tries to call him, his phone's cut off. So we go by the house, knock on the door, he answers, and he's just gotten out of bed. He says, hey, let me take a shower. So you wait, and he finally comes out, and he says, hey, can we take my girlfriend home? So you take the girlfriend home, drop her off, and Stevie says, hey, anybody need to go to the music store? No, Stevie, we've all been. He says, well, I need to get some guitar strings. So they go to the guitar store. And they think they're finally on their way, and Stevie says, hey, have y'all eaten lunch? And yes, Stevie, we've all eaten lunch. He says, well, can we go buy Dan's Hamburgers and let me grab a few? So of course, you know, all right, Stevie, we'll go. We're never going to get this trip underway. So they get to the Dan's Hamburgers, and Stevie says, can somebody lend me $5? So Denny says, he was a little irresponsible, like a lot of people are when they're 20, so we would get frustrated. But it was really difficult to get mad at Stevie and harder to stay mad at him because he was sweet and funny and nice, and he kept that sweetness throughout his life. Next slide. I'm going to run through these slides a little bit quickly because I want to make sure there's time for some question and answer. This was a fairly historic night. The Rolling Stones actually asked the band to come to New York and play a private gig for them. As it turns out, the Rolling Stones were considering adding Stevie's band to the Rolling Stone record label. That didn't ultimately happen because they felt like blues wouldn't sell. But this is Ronnie Wood of the Rolling Stones watching Stevie play up in New York. Next slide, please. This is, in 1982, a couple of things happened with Stevie's career that really shot him into the stratosphere, or at least headed him that way. And this was at the Montreux Jazz Festival in Switzerland. And it was on this night that he met Jackson Browne, who you can see in the center photograph. And Jackson, after seeing Stevie play, offered him free use of his studio in Los Angeles. And when Stevie took advantage of that over the Thanksgiving holiday, that ended up being Stevie's first record, first album. And he also met David Bowie, which you see down in the bottom picture at the far right. And after Bowie saw Stevie play at this same concert, he offered him a gig to play guitar on his next album, and it became Bowie's best-selling album of his career. It was called Let's Dance. And there's a lot of songs, David Bowie songs, played on the radio, and a lot of people don't know that Stevie playing guitar on some of those famous hit songs. Next slide, please. Stevie had an alter ego called Brady. It's pronounced Blady. And this is just some of my favorite pictures. You know, the people who are around Stevie a lot said he wasn't really a joke teller, but he had a great sense of humor, and he had these characters that he would play, and this is some of his characters. Next slide. A couple of just general pictures that I like. The one at the top right is actually at the record release party for the first album, and they're just clowning around backstage. And then the bottom picture is Stevie trying out amplifiers at the famous Power Station studio in New York. I just like that shot. That's Stevie playing at a record company convention in Honolulu. Actually, Jeff Beck was on stage with him.
That is number one.
That is the guitar that everybody calls number one. Next slide, please. Top left is Stevie with little Steven Van Zandt in Germany at a festival. And then the other picture is one of my favorites. It was sent to me by a fan who was at this German music festival. And I assume that what this is that this is the VIP facilities for the band. And apparently Stevie thought it was funny too. Next slide. A couple of my favorite pictures of Stevie interacting with his fans. One thing that everybody who was close to Stevie would remark is that he was always available to his fans. He would not leave a venue until everybody who wanted an autograph had one, and management would have to literally drag him away to get him to stop signing autographs. And I like both of these pictures. One is a record store appearance in New York with a young fan, and then the other one is a concert also in New York. And one just coincidental thing, the guy who took the picture at the top is in the picture at the bottom, and he's the one in the center with his camera up to his face, right behind the woman who's reaching up trying to touch the tip of Stevie's boot. Next picture. This one I like just because it took me a while to figure out what was going on in this photograph, because I didn't know where it was taken when I first saw it, and I started looking and I thought, hey, the audience is all men. And then I started to realize they're all wearing similar clothes, and then I saw a big high fence in the back, and it dawned on me he's playing at a prison. And I talked to the photographer later who took the picture, and he said that little line across there, that little cord, that's the sum total of the security for the band. Because the guards are not allowed in the prison yard because they would be so heavily outnumbered, it would be far too risky for there to actually be guards in with the prisoners. So as I talked to Chris Layton or Reese Winans, I can't remember which, one of them told me, they said, you know, finally you go through this one set of double gates and the guards just say, see ya. And then you go out there and you're on your own. Next slide, please. This is, when you know what's going on here, this is a fairly awesome photograph because Stevie's not just holding an 8-pound guitar above his head by the neck. He's actually playing the song. It's a song called Life Without You that he dedicated to Charlie Wirth, who started Charlie's guitar shop in Dallas. And the woman who was a friend of Stevie's that took this picture said he told her that he only tried this one other time and he couldn't do it. And he felt like this one time, the first time he tried it, Charlie was helping him up in heaven, because Charlie had just died. Next slide. I use this just to kind of illustrate a transition in Stevie's life. In 1986, he went through rehab, cleaned up, lived the rest of his life clean and sober, and I still get emails and letters, and I meet people at every event that I go to who say that they owe their sobriety to Stevie's example. Next slide. Just a couple of the clowning picture up in the top. And then if you've got really sharp eyes, you will see this bolo tie on Stevie in the picture with Stevie Wonder. Next slide. This is the band doing a music video. That's Chris, Tommy, and Reese. They don't actually play horns. This was just for a video. Next slide. My favorite picture of Stevie with B.B. King, and you can just see the mutual respect in their faces. And it's just one of the most powerful images, two artists who obviously adore each other. That was taken at Stevie's last Dallas performance in 1990. And then the other picture is Stevie and his mother, Martha. And the photographer asked her if she knew who Pete Townsend was. She says, oh yeah. He said, well, I want you to do that, you know, that windmill guitar lick, and just keep doing that. And he started taking pictures, and I just love the expression on Stevie's face. It was a great picture. The next slide. Stevie was killed in a helicopter crash immediately after a show in Wisconsin on August the 26th of 90. And Stevie had played with Double Trouble a full set, and then Eric Clapton came out and his band played. And then at the end of Eric's performance, he called some of the guitar players, Stevie, Robert Cray, Buddy Guy, out on stage to do an encore with him, with Eric. And because of the photos that were taken, we know that in the set that Stevie did with his band, he was wearing a white shirt. And he only wore this purple tie-dye shirt for that encore. And so we know for a fact that this is one of the last pictures ever taken of Stevie. And he died just a few hours later. Next slide. And this is a slide. There was a documentary on TV about Stevie some years ago, and this was the picture of all the hundreds of pictures in that documentary that people kept asking me, where can I get a copy of that picture? And it took me a long time to find it, but I finally did. It's Stevie in New Zealand on his last vacation with his girlfriend, Jana, and it's in the book. Next slide. That's it.